Greetings, viewers. Eric the Car Guy back again with more rear suspension upgrades to my Fairmont project. Yes, we've decided to make a few changes to make things better in the back, and Maximum Motorsports has kind of helped me out here. In fact, before me, I have a new Panhard bar set up. In the previous video, we installed the torque arm, and that helped control our axle in one direction, and this will help control our axle in a side-to-side direction. Some might say, hey, Eric, why not go for a Watts link? Well, because I'm putting on a Panhard bar, that's why. And that's what this video is about. So if you want to see a video about a Watts link, go watch something else. If you want to see a Panhard bar installation on a Fox body, keep watching. Our pieces, the players, the large pieces, the big brace that's going to attach to the body. This will take the place of our lower shock mount on the driver's side, I'm sorry. And this is the actual Panhard bar that goes between the two. In fact, it will connect in here and in here, something like this, once we get everything all set up correctly. But we need to attach this to the quote-unquote subframe of the vehicle. Here's our hardware. Came with all that. And my guess is you probably need it. Here's the hardware all spread out. And here we are, ground zero, the back of the vehicle. And by the way, this information will also pertain to Mustangs, other Fox bodies, things like that. So if you have a Fox body, you're looking to install one of these Maximum Motorsports Panhard bars, this video is for you. I've already removed the fuel tank because it just makes things easier. I also had a fuel filter and a fuel pump here that I have also removed. I've done that to figure out where this thing goes and put it into place a little bit easier. I've also left the coil springs out. And the reason I've done that is so that I can position this whole assembly wherever I want it to be. So I can check for clearance, I can check full travel all the way to the stops, and make sure everything's gonna work like it's supposed to before I put the coil springs in. So in addition to removing the fuel tank for space, the springs are out so I can move this whole thing around. And this is roughly what position it will be in, which is part of the challenge here. But the first step is to remove this shock on the driver's side because we are going to replace this bracket with our new bracket. I did mention to remove the coil springs. I did mention to measure the ride height before you take the coil springs out and everything else, but I forgot to mention to measure the distance between the tire and the inner fender on both sides to figure out where the axle was lined up. That is also important. And I didn't do that before I got started on all this. I'm regretting it now. But this Panhard bar, when we install it, we're gonna center everything up and make sure it's awesome. And it's gonna take a little bit to set it up once we get everything in place. Be prepared for that. This driver's side shock mount needs to be replaced. Support the axle tube on this side. You might have also already removed the lower control arm and coil spring. I just need to bring it up a little bit. I never tightened this down. I knew I was going to be coming back to do this. Now we need to remove this lower shock mount. I'm also going to remove this lower control arm bolt over on this side. Yes, I didn't tighten that one either. But this will need to be out of the way. Shock needs to be out of the way. This needs to get removed. It is an 18 millimeter. With the control arm drop down, I've compressed the shock, which keeps coming back. It's kind of annoying. And I'm going to install this bracket in here. And it goes like that. There is this shorter bolt, it's, what is it, 1/2 inch by 1 1/4 on the back side. I'll be putting this washer and this nylock nut. The instructions specifically state not to put a washer underneath this bolt head because it will cause interference with the shock. So when it goes in here, it's bolt only. But before I even go here, I want to show you something. This shock, this is where the shock mount will be, and the Panhard bar will come into here, and the lower control arm bolt will go through here. But the shock needs to go up onto here, and it's clear to see that it's just a little too wide. Given that I have space now, I'm gonna remove that metal sleeve. I'm going to clearance it so that it fits before I go to my next step. I don't think he wants to come out of there. That may be enough though. I'm going for it. Unfortunately, that shock is just going to be in the way. I'm going to start by running it down with this, and then it gets torqued to 119 foot-pounds. And they made mention that you need to check the alignment of the control arm bolt holes. They say that if these don't line up when you're done tightening everything up, that this is bent and it could be caused by aftermarket coilovers, blah, blah, blah. So watch out for that. And they say to fix it, you gotta bend it back into place is how you're gonna fix it. You may need to run a file in these holes to get things to line up. My hope is that it gets close enough for me to put the bolt in. Then I was going to thread the bolt through the control arm bolt through here to just sort of have it in position when I tighten everything down. I wasn't gonna do the control arm, just the bolt. Now with the correct size socket, let's see how it works out. Hey, that works better. Stupid shock is gonna be the death of me. This might require a little bit of clearancing. Now I can swing the hammer. The hole's gotta get a little bit bigger. The instructions say that if it's within an eighth of an inch, which we are, you can just go in with a file, rat tail file like this, clearance it out a little bit. That takes a while. So I thought of using my angle die grinder and going in and making the hole larger like this. And then I thought, well, first of all, I thought I should probably tighten the bit inside of my tool. But then I was like, yeah, that's gonna leave the holes sort of egg-shaped and elongated. So I've gone to this, my universal bit. I'm just gonna go up like one step on each side, and I'm hoping that will get me the clearance that I need. I may have a couple of burrs on the inside. I'll fit it, but before I do final assembly, I'm gonna come back in and just paint these holes, let that dry. In the instructions, it's like so easy. It's like, hey, put it on there. And no. Gonna go down to that next step. Just give that a try. I'm gonna grab the bolt I think they wanna replace that one with. They gave me a new lower control arm bolt. And I'm pretty sure that's because it needs to be a tad longer. Let's see if I'm right. Perfect. Now I'm gonna run this bolt down now that I know that's gonna come out okay. I feel more confident if that wasn't as bound up. Because it seems a little bound up. And I wasn't so much worried about making these holes larger because these were the same size in here. And I already knew that they were straight and the bolt would go through. They locate this so that as the forces are applied to this area, it's still held in place by these inner ones. That's why I'm not going to go in and enlarge these inner holes. But I will make these outer ones large enough so that this can pass through comfortably. It's not finally torqued, but it doesn't feel as comfortable. It could be slightly more comfy. I'm just gonna come in with that file and just file in here. Who put this jack in the way? I'm gonna make short work of this. Awesome. All it needed was a little help. 119 foot-pounds. I'm just gonna read the instructions to you because I was sort of having a laugh. And see if you can understand what this says. Install the provided 12mm by 1.75 by 117mm pivot bolt and 12mm flange nut with the half-inch washer under the bolt head through the Panhard bar axle mount, the axle's lower control arm mount, and the control arm bushing crush sleeve. Insert the bolt from the inboard side of the mounting bracket. Snug by hand, but do not torque. You know what all that means? Reinstall the lower control arm with the bolt like this. With the washer on like that. Apparently they want me to go in from this side, fine, but they, all those words mean do this. Whoops. Hey, there's some action for you. Too bad it's not 3D, right? Bet you would have dropped your popcorn. Don't tighten it yet. The instructions don't explicitly say to remount the shock into place. I want to do it just so that I can have control of this whole action. Just get this out of here, because if I let this out, this whole thing's going to drop down. I don't want it to do that. So I'm just going to mount the shock just with the bolt through, just holding it in place. You know what though? I bet the bolt's got to go through the other way. Doesn't look like that flange nut is going to fit in there. Looks like it'll fit there fine though. Just doing that finger tight for now. It's an awful lot of trouble for one little thing. The next part in the instructions goes through a lot of stuff and gets kind of confusing, but they tell you to remove the coil spring over here on the passenger side, which has already been done. The object here for the next whole set of instructions is to make sure that when the Panhard bar is finally installed in its final resting place, that it is dead nuts straight across. So in other words, it doesn't vary one direction to the other. So in other words, it doesn't mount up here a little bit further back than it does up here. It needs to mount equidistant from this mount to this mount. So you want to position this up where it's going to go, which is really going to be right up against these bump stops and these frame rails. And I mean, like, jam it in there. But the idea is that when this thing gets bolted in, this needs to be level and straight with this. So when you install that bar is straight across. So the next set of measurements I do will be all about that. I will try and position this in its final resting place. And as I said, it'll be likely right up against those bump stops. I'm gonna try and see if this works. No. All right, been fiddling around with this a little bit off camera. I need to fit the frame mount of the Panhard bar assembly up to the vehicle. Thing is, the shocks are in the way on both sides. Those are where I need to mark and drill holes and things. So I need to remove the shocks. The instructions state that I should have removed them by now. In fact, they should have been out of the way for this whole fiasco here. Anyway, gotta get the shocks off, but I also have to find some way to support the differential because all the weight's gonna pull down on it and it's gonna rip that brake line up on the top right out of there. Got to come up with a plan to figure out how to remove the shocks and hold the differential in place while we work. Hi. That's right. I'm high. Up here. Working on a lift, I need to disconnect the upper shock mounts. But the problem is if I lower the car down to do that, the whole differential drops down, like I said. So the solution is I'm going to disconnect the upper shock mounts while the differential is being supported underneath. And that way I don't have to worry about the whole thing falling down. Yeah, it really sucks working on a lift. You know, this is where you guys working on the ground with jack stands really have me beat. Not, it's never not cool to have a lift. In fact, call your Benpack dealer now. Okay, upper shock mounts are disconnected. They should drop right out the bottom now. This was handy. Right, should have done this way sooner. Read the instructions, Eric. Fine. For this next part, I'm gonna get my friend Bob, first name Plum, and this tape measure. I need to measure the distance to the inside edge of this bracket, which is where the Panhard bar will attach eventually. So I need to measure from here, and I'm gonna hang the Plum Bob off of the axle tube to give myself a reference point. So I'll go right up here under the brake line. I could go on this backside, but it's sort of at the edge here, you can see the axle's a little bit tapered. and I don't want to get into that spot. Unless I do it the same on both sides. The point being is you need to do this the same on both sides. But anywho, I'm going to sort of eyeball a measurement from Mr. Bob here to the inside edge of this bracket. This measurement is going to be very important for us. And looking at it, about 4 1/4 from the axle tube. Try not to pull on the string. It's kind of tricky measuring things this way, but it's pretty darn accurate. I'm gonna take that 4 1/4 number and use that as my baseline for installing the frame part of the mount. So I'm gonna mock it up in here and I'm going to measure from the mounting point on the frame mount to the axle tube in the same way, and I'm looking for 4 1/4. You get up to a 1/2 inch, so if it's a 1/2 inch off, or within 1/2 inch, I should say, you should be okay. But I'm gonna try to get it as close to 4 1/4 as possible, if I can. You might have been wondering why this jack stand's been here this whole time. I've been doing some stuff off camera. I did mention that. One of the things I did off camera was I got this up into place to try to figure out its location and how to hold it up in place. The instructions have something very specific. What they suggest is, first of all, this needs to position in such a way to where it's like right up against the bump stops on both sides and the frame rail. You want to hold this thing in this position so you can mark the holes that you're going to need to drill through the frame rails, and also take the measurement for the one I just mentioned as far as the relationship between this and the axle tube. I came up with this method to where I'm going to take this jack stand and use it to hold the bar up and also allow me the ability to move this around a little bit. But you can drill a hole through here into the frame rail in the middle, just a small hole, just enough for like a sheet metal screw, and run a sheet metal screw in on both sides, and that will also hold it into place. This is very precariously placed, and sometimes it moves on me. And I don't know how accurate it is since it's just held up in there by that jack stand. But looking at this on this side, I'm at 5 inches. So, 4 1/4 and 5 inches, I'm right at the ragged edge of that 1/2 inch. I don't really like that, and I'm kind of wondering if there's some way I can fudge this into position to get this closer to that 4 1/4, and if I can, I want to do it. I've had this thought. I've enlisted the help of cameraman Brian here because this part would be a two-man job. Since I haven't drilled the mounting holes yet, I'm wondering if I can just sort of pivot this back towards the axle to take up some of that slack to get it closer to that 4 1/4 inch range, and then drill my holes up there accordingly. Now that's gonna leave a little bit of a gap between the frame rail and the mounting of the Panhard bar. But I have an idea for that as well. And I've actually talked to the people about Maximum Motorsports about this, and they said, you should be okay. But here's what I'm doing. Because really, it's being held in place by the bolts. And being firm up against the frame rail means that there's less, the stresses that are transmitted are solidly transmitted into the frame rails, which is kind of the point. But like I said, I've got an idea. Cameraman Brian's gonna measure up, and I'm going to sort of angle this back towards him to try and get it into that sweet spot we're looking for.
That's it right there.
Right there?
It's pretty darn close, yeah.
4 1/4s right there? All right.
Yep.
You'll allow me to sneak in here. I'm gonna mark the holes. Also the outside. Now you may be saying, Eric, didn't they tell you to make sure that it was mounted flush up against the frame rails? Well, yes they did. And here's my idea to deal with the fact that this isn't going to be flush because I angled it back. I'm going to take this piece of steel here, it's just big enough, and use it as a shim in this area. I'm going to weld this up into place so that when this gets mounted, this will extend the frame rail down far enough to where it is making contact here and make it a little more of a secure fit. You can weld these into place. Thing is, they tell you to bolt it into place first, drive it around, make sure everything is good, because if you weld it into place and it's not right, you got a lot of grinding to do to make it right. Keep that in mind. So I'm going to actually leave mine bolted. I'm not going to weld it. I'm going to need to get to this differential at some point. I'm going to want to be able to take this thing off and make it serviceable. I think we will start by drilling the holes, and I'll get everything mounted into place, and then I will size this up and figure that part out. Here's the marked area, and I'm going to drill small holes to start with through the center of those to get everything into position. Do the same thing on the other side. I'm gonna drop the suspension down so that it's easier to drill the holes. If you're on the ground and you're watching this video and you're wondering how to do all this stuff on the ground, anytime you see one of these jacks, think floor jack. You just wanna make sure that your jack stands are both at the same height. You don't want it off one way or the other. Other thing is you want all four wheels up off the ground and the vehicle as level as possible when you're doing a lot of this work. That's much better. The holes need to be drilled to 3/8. They recommend starting with a small hole and then going larger and larger until you get to size. They also recommend using really sharp drill bits. I have found these drill bits that I've been using for a little bit. I'll link them down in the description. Work extremely well, and I bet I can do it all in one pass. The other takeaway here, do not drill all the way through the frame rail. Just drill through the first layer. Just the first layer. So in other words, you're just making holes in this piece of metal, not all the way through. Okay, I have the first hole drilled, but I was a little bit mistaken on the hole size. I'm starting with a 3/8, but the hole, when it's done, needs to be 5/8. So in essence, I can call this a pilot hole. At least I didn't drill the hole too big. Three-eighths holes are done. Now I'm gonna go get a larger drill bit so I can make the bigger holes. I have a stepped drill bit, and you're saying to yourself, you might be saying to yourself, why didn't you just start with that to begin with? Well, on the other side, I think I will. I'm gonna drill a smaller pilot hole, and I'm just gonna go with this. I have marked on a drill bit here where the 5/8 is down in the valley there, so it will alert me to when I've reached that point. Or you could put a piece of tape around the outside, whatever. This is what's gotta slide into the hole. Almost there. Next step up. So when this slides in, I'm good. Nice. I'm gonna go in with a file, deburr the hole a little. Perfect. Okay, now I'm gonna finish up on this side, if you will. This is gonna be too long to go all the way through, and that's fine. You don't want this to pass all the way through. But what you want is you wanna cut these tubes to size so that when you tighten everything down, everything crushes against these sleeves and doesn't crush the frame rail. This is like a very special piece and a very important part of this whole thing. So the next step is to measure the depths of these holes and transfer those measurements to each of these tubes, which will likely be different for each tube, and cut these to size so that when this goes down in here, it fits flush. Since there's two of these assemblies, and this is gonna be specific from one side to the next, I'm gonna mark this one as an R, since I'm on the right side, and since it's the R is positioned this way, I can't flip it over, you know, because it won't read right. So that this one is R. So now I'm gonna get the depth of this hole and transfer that measurement over to this assembly. Two ways you can do this. There's the scientific method, or the method that can probably work. I'll show you both. For the scientific method, I have this caliper here that has a part that comes off the back, sticks out the back for measurements there. Can run that down into the hole as far as it goes. And there we are. In fact, you can just do this with a caliper. You don't even have to like technically measure it. All right, there's the front hole depth. And that is going to be 215 inches, or 2 5/32 in fractions, or 54.82 millimeters. Since this front hole is the one that I just measured, I can actually take that and mark it right at that spot like that if I want. Let's see, yeah. Or I can just transfer it like this. So this is the front tube that I'm marking here. So that one's gotta get cut right there. The unscientific way that'll probably work will be to take a screwdriver, bottom it out in the hole, mark where it bottoms out,
So for this one, I'm just going to take that mark, whoops, and transfer it over to the tube there.
So you want to check to see if that method's accurate, right? You want to use a scientific method to transfer it over? I know how you are.
It's pretty darn close to me. So now I'm going to cut these tubes. The instructions say to cut a 16th to a 10th of an inch shorter. And the reason they want that is so that there's a little bit of crush on everything. Because if this sticks out too far, when you go to tighten it all down, it'll be a little sloppy. But if you cut it just a little bit short, everything will smoosh down right onto the edge of this, and that's what they want. So I'm going to cut on the inside of my marks is basically what I'm going to do. Instead of the outside, instead of right on, I'm going to cut on the inside.
You can do this with a hacksaw. This is a hacksaw on compressed air.
I'll take that over and clean it up on the bench grinder.
Before I go clean these up on the bench grinder, on the way by, I thought I'd do a test fit, sort of see where they were at. And what I find is the bracket for the bump stop holds this up a little bit too much. So this one is actually a little bit short. But then I'm like, hey, wait a minute. Looking at this, it looks like this one that was in the back is a little bit longer. So if I just flip this around, I think it'll be okay.
This side over here is just barely touching the backside, and I can actually feel through this hole the other one that is also about where it needs to be. So I'm okay with this, but I'm gonna remember this on the next side and add a little bit to this one. I can always make it shorter, I can't make it longer. So if you're gonna make a mistake long instead of short. Now I'm gonna insert this in here for reals and clamp it down. The reason why we're going through all this is because we want to, when we're all done, be able to slide the bolts through everything and everything lines up perfect. Unlike what we had with that lower mount over there, bolts just slide right in, no problems. So we're following these procedures in order to accomplish that. This will hold it in place while I drill 3/8 holes through both of these, through the other side. It's gonna go right through the tube and drill through the frame rail on the other side. Now let's move to the other side, do it all over again. I see tiny bugs crawling on my car. Oh well, they'll achieve warp speed. This one's tough because it's right up next to this bump stop bracket. I got a drill right underneath it. So I'm gonna try to find the smallest drill bit I have and start with that. Okay, battery's toast. Got to switch to a different drill. Oh no, I put a scratch on it. No. Ah. Oh, there's a scratch back here too, but still no. Good thing I haven't painted it yet. I made short work of it. Now I'm gonna mark this one L so that the L faces up. File the holes a little bit. Transfer the depth measurements and do some cutting. Now this time when I do my measurement for this back one, I'm gonna make sure that I'm on this high spot here. Since this is the front one, there's the L. That one was not so straight. I'm really disappointed in myself. Some of you may have noticed that my last cut on this was a little bit crooked, and that's my fault. There is a better way of doing this. First of all, this may not be the right tool, although it did work. You can use a hacksaw just by hand, and that would be great, but when I started using the cutoff wheel, things would get a lot better. It would be really great if I had a bandsaw, and actually one of my followers on Twitter cued me into something that he did with a portable handheld DeWalt. I think that was Wingless something, I can't remember the last names. Anyway,
You know who you are. Here's an idea that you can use. What I did before to try and cut a line around the outside of this is I just sort of drew it by hand, freehand. Not exactly the best method, but if you lay down a piece of tape, like I'm doing here, it can act as a really good guide for cutting. So the next time I go to cut something like this and measure it out, I'm going to do it this way as opposed to what I showed in the video. And yeah, I was able to get the one in the video to work out, so just know that. But this would be a better method as far as marking and cutting than what I just previously showed. Because my clamp popped off, I'm just going to run a bolt through. This stupid chuck would stay together. I'm going to clamp that down too. Sad thing is, we still got four more holes to drill. For the next step, now that we have all our holes drilled and everything's deburred and everything's happy, we're going to insert this up into place and slide all the bolts through. You may have noticed that these holes have not been drilled yet, so we need to go in and drill these holes, and we're going to do it similar to what we did with the frame rails and the sleeves. Make sure the bolts pass all the way through and come into contact. Yeah, we've got a little wiggle room with this too, which may be helpful. We'll have to take our measurement again before we do our final assembly. But now that it's held up into place, we're going to remove the bolts one by one and run that same 3/8 drill bit through everything so that we get our holes drilled on this side. I'll deburr this when it's on the ground because it's kind of tied up in here. So I'll just take it off and do that before I do final assembly. Now, however, that I've got the hole drilled, insert the bolt all the way through and install one of my nylock nuts. And repeat the process all the way around. So I noticed something. I've got the first hole drilled and this whole thing will pivot back and forth like this. And I want to be sure that I get my hole drilled exactly in the spot where I wanted it, since I'm making an adjustment. So I got cameraman Brian over here taking the measurement while I have this brace that I'm going to twist into position so that I can lift it up so that we get the reading that we want. Right there?
Yeah.
I use this brace to hold everything in place while I drill this hole over here. That way I'm assured that everything is lined up the way I want it. Now I've changed the mounting point over here, or the support point, I should probably call it, to try to make sure that stays in position. And we've measured that out. It's at 4 1/4. So before I drill this final hole over here, I just wanted to make sure that everything was lined up. Still have it in position here. Same thing on this side. Now that all four holes are drilled and the bolts are in place, we know the relative position that everything is going to be in. So I want to check this one more time. Which would be that 4 1/4, or right close to it. I'm sure you noticed this gap in here. I mentioned I had a plan for that, and I have this steel that I'm gonna weld to the frame. This will be up a little more like this. So in essence, I'm gonna take up that space with this steel. But before I do that, I'm going to bolt the Panhard bar into place and check clearance of everything. And if everything looks good, then I'll take this all down, I'll finish cleaning all the holes and probably paint the inside of these holes so that it helps prevent corrosion. And then we'll fasten this thing down in permanently. Then we gotta do our adjustments. Got two giant fasteners. One is shorter than the other. The shorter one goes in here, and this is just mocking it up and checking for clearance. But you're supposed to put, when you put this in here, you're supposed to have a washer on either side of this when it goes up in. For now, Like I said, I'm gonna check full travel to check my clearance. Cool. Without the shocks in here, I don't know all the way down what that would be. Well, I suppose I could actually, wait, I can do this. So for the moment, I'm just gonna mock this shock into place. It's funny, just so I can see where full down is. And right about there, looks like all the way down. So that's as far down as this assembly is gonna be able to go. Plenty of clearance now with it all the way bottomed out. Now I'm gonna run it all the way up to the stops and see what it looks like. Now if you're doing this on the ground, just put a floor jack under it and a block of wood. That's with the suspension completely bottomed out. Tons of clearance. So now with this in place and no shocks, we can actually see the kind of suspension movement that we like to see, which is like this. As we're driving down the road, this is the side to side that we'll see, or the up and down from side to side that we'll see, but no back and forth. I mean, it's not, this is gonna stay centered. Awesome. My metal and how far it's going to go in and get my pieces cut. And then I'll drop it down and I'll mark all these pieces, prep the surface for weld, and then just weld these guys in real quick. And that way I'll have something under there and they won't have a tendency to move around as much. Since I'm gonna put shims up underneath the mounts, I'm going to drop this whole thing down. I'm gonna prep that surface. Then I'm gonna mock everything up and tack weld them into place so I know exactly where they're gonna be. And then I'll take all this back out, weld that stuff in, put this back up in. That'll do. Thicker metal here, and it fits in there better. It's just leftover stuff that I got at the hardware store. That is a snug fit, and I like that. Get ourselves a piece of this and see how it fits in there. That's kind of awesome. It looks like two will fit in there perfectly. Baby, got some hot stuff, baby. Baby didn't know. That's how I cool it down. I sing. It's important that you sing, because if you're not singing, it doesn't cool off properly. When asked how I feel about that, pretty darn good. This piece works, but it looks like I'm gonna need a longer piece for the other side. I'm gonna tack these into place and then I'll finish up after I remove the Panhard bar support. Since these aren't fully up against the frame, I'm gonna push them up with this lady slipper while I tack them down. But they're fully seated down in there, so when this thing gets bolted up and what have you, it will fit flush. Let's consider for a moment what we're trying to do here. All I want is to tack those into place so they don't move around, because really they're just acting as spacers. In other words, I don't need to weld bead around the outside of the whole stinking thing.
I probably will around the front, but I want to tack the back down first. That's all we're doing. We're gonna grind that back one down a little bit. Well, I guess that's gonna work. We'll pull it out, put a coat of paint on it, put a coat on the inside of this, wait for that stuff to dry, and assemble it for real. These are made wide. So if you have wider frame rails, great. If you don't, it came with four of these shims that you can place in between the frame rail and the Panhard bar connector. And I'm gonna do that because I do have enough space to put one of these on each side. I really do. I don't want to go in that side. Yeah, won't quite go in. This side. It's got me thinking, if I ever go to service this in the future and I have to pull these bolts out, I'm gonna have to pull them out past the shock if I'm over on this side. So I think I'm gonna go in from here and put the nuts on the outside instead of the inside. That way, if I ever do need to service this and get past the shock, I won't have to worry about it. Recheck the measurement. I'll be honest, right now, it's just a shade over four. We're still within that half an inch. It's happy, so I'm much better with a quarter inch off than a half an inch. I'll check it again when we got it tightened down. As you probably noticed, these bolts are not quite long enough, but when we tighten everything down, it'll all crush up and it'll all be to size. And because we have those sleeves inside the frame rail, we're not gonna crush the frame rail, we're just gonna crush everything on the outside and it's gonna be in position. I've got the jack stand under here. Remember, I was on the light side of my measurement at 4 1/4. Actually, I measured in at 4 inches, so I've got this under here putting pressure up like this while I tighten to try to put this in the best position possible. If I'm within 1/4 inch, I'm fine. But because these bolts aren't quite long enough right now, I'm going to have to take the washer off of this one temporarily and tighten it a little bit until it crushes down a little bit, and then put the washer on and then put the nut back on and start the process over. At final torque on these is gonna be 47 foot-pounds. These are 14 millimeter. Now the bolts are just starting to get to where the nylock is. Let's run the other side down a little bit. We'll go to final torque. Getting close to that final torque, and you can see that the nylon is being engaged. Once again, I'm at the top of the range of the torque wrench, and it concerns me. The deformation in the washers says to me that it's about as tight as I want it. I don't want to go any tighter than that. I fear to go any tighter than that. I don't see those going anywhere. Maximum Motorsports does say in their instructions, after you've been driving this 1,000 miles, to go back and retorque everything. That might be the time to finish that off. It's about as far as I dare go on those too. Bolts are protruding through nylock nuts. Everything's deformed and squished. This thing it's one with the frame now, which is what it needs to be. I want to do one final measurement since, well, this is, in essence, the final answer. So, we're not quite 4 1/4, but we're a lot closer than, what was it, 5 we were at before. I'm gonna resign myself to be happy with that. Now I'm gonna install the bar for real.
This in here is 27 millimeters, but this is slightly larger. I just grabbed this adjustable wrench, loosened everything up. Now what I'd like to do is find out where the middle is. It looks like it's already been coated with some anti-seize, so I don't think you need to go there. But what I want to do is I want to get this embedded halfway in to the rod assembly. So now that I've got this all the way out, I'm going to mark it about where I think halfway is and then just run it into there. That way I've got full adjustment going both ways. It doesn't come like that. It comes bottomed out inside the assembly, but I'll know if I just run it down to there, I'm about halfway. Same over here. Right-hand thread on this side. If I was smart, I would have measured the other side at the halfway point and just transfer that measurement over to here, but I'm not smart. I'm tired of supporting this thing with this jack stand. I want it out of the way. I'm gonna reinstall my shocks and then the bar, because shocks gotta go in here. Bars in here, it'll just be in my way. It's hot up there. I can now drop this down. You need one of the supplied washers underneath the bolt head. When you insert the bar, you need to have a washer on either side of the pivot. So that's designed to have all that together. On this side, you don't need a washer for the back because the nut is welded into the assembly. They specifically state that when you take this and put this up in here, that these two centerpieces be completely in line. It's super important. Right now I'm going to shorten it up so I can get the bolt through. So in other words, you don't want this cocked to one side or the other. You want it bang on in relation to the other side. Same drill with this one. One under the bolt head, one on either side of the rod, and one before the nut. So I'm gonna say my measurements were pretty on because this is going up in fairly easily. Nice. And we can lengthen or shorten it by turning the rod like this. But we don't make final adjustment until we've installed the coil springs and we've set the ride height. So we can't do the final adjustments, which is setting this up as far as where it goes in this slot or setting it up for the distance until we get those springs installed. I'm gonna install the stabilizer bar next because I don't wanna have the springs installed while I do that. After that's done, we'll come back, we'll do our final adjustments, close out the video. And we're back. As you can see, there's been some additions to our suspension, including the rear coil springs. We've also had the opportunity to check ride height, which is where we needed to be in order to make the final adjustments on this rod. Now, I think it's worth mentioning that I looked over the instructions before doing this adjustment. And one of the things they state is before the installation of this rod is to take the vehicle out, drive it around to settle the suspension before its installation. My engine isn't running, so I wasn't able to do that. However, my intention is to come back after I've got everything all running and together and on the road for a little bit and recheck everything. I believe in the instructions, they say come back in about 1,000 miles and recheck all of your adjustments. I say it's probably not a bad idea to come back in like 500 miles, just recheck and make sure everything's where it's supposed to be. In addition to measuring the ride height, so from the fender to the inside of the axle there, another measurement that I'm gonna take is from the tire to the inner part of the fender on both sides. So that I can get that close or set up virtually the same when we're all done with the installation of our parts. And this one looks like it's just under 2 inches. Let's check the other side. Over on the driver's side, measurement here looks like a little more than 1.5, about 1 5/8 or so. That means there's about a 1/4 inch difference between this side and the passenger side. And that wouldn't necessarily be uncommon. They even state this in the instructions. due to manufacturing tolerances and things in the late 70s, they weren't necessarily the same par that we have today. Additionally, it could have been in a collision, the fender could be slightly off, but I'm gonna make this my target, or this my baseline as far as where I'm gonna try to land the wheels when I get it back together, or I might try to make it just a little bit more even. We'll have to wait and see. Anyway, let's get started.
One of the first things I wanna do is level out this rod. Now that this thing is on the ground, it's best if it's just straight across and there is no angle to it. So I'm gonna put this level on it, and I can already see that it's a little bit off. And unfortunately, I can't use the magnet part of this, but it looks like it could go down just a little bit more over on this side. Thing is I think this is all the way down in the slot. And a part of me is thinking, I wonder if I made that slot slightly bigger, how bad that would be. And the reason why I'm concerned is because if this is straight across, the forces that are applied to it go straight across. If it's slightly up like this, the forces might make it want to do this a little bit. Now, is that the end of the world? No, I don't think so, but if I'm going to set this up, I want to set it up the best I can. That means just slotting this opening here a little bit more down towards the bottom, as long as I don't compromise its integrity, I'll be okay with that. But yeah, just down a little bit more, like maybe like that much. I'm gonna lift it up and see if that's possible.
I'm gonna remove the bolt here, see how much room we have to work with. I think there's a little room there. As far as I'm gonna go though, I won't go below that. Even better, I'll measure from here to here, find out what this distance is, find out where I want it to be, measure both sides before I do any work, so that I'm sure that it's even on both sides. My closest approximation here is about 5/8, but we'll just make it easy. We'll just go down to about there. That seems like too much. I'm gonna come in about there. That's only about 1/4 inch. So both sides, only 1/4 inch. And it'll probably be easier to do if I take this wheel off. I'm gonna do 1/4 inch on this side also. Right about there. Before I do anything, I was just laying the washer on here just to get a look at where things would be once I did that elongation. In fact, I might even use this as something of a template. There's still plenty down below here. I don't want to go down that far, but I think just that little bit might get me in a happier place. It might not get me exactly level, but I think it'll get me close. But the washer will still be completely seated in here, so it won't be hanging over the edge is what I'm getting at. I may stop there. I can always go more if I need to, but I can't go back if it's too much. Well, to be honest, doesn't seem like it went down all that much. Keep going, I guess. Yeah. Seems like we made a bit of progress. Don't like how it kicked over there, but... And I'm about the same over on this side. In fact, I'm a little more down on this side. There. I don't want to leave the exposed metal for rust, and I don't want to spray paint it the black color that I have because it is a shiny finish and this is a dull finish. So rather than trying to spray something, I have some touch-up paint here that's not even black. It's ice teal if you're curious. Nothing else. It will help inhibit rust. Well, I'll give that a minute to dry. I'm gonna sweep my floor. Gonna reinstall the bolt and see how well I did. And yes, I still have to reconnect the stabilizer bar, and I'm kind of thankful for that because it made getting in there a little easier. Now remember, we've got our complex washer stacking. So there's a washer on the outside, but there's also a washer on either side of this when it's up in there like that. There it is. About as far as it'll go.
Yeah, it's not quite there, but it's mostly there. I do like it better there than where it was. It seemed a bit excessive before, but I dare not take any more out of that. So I'll just have to leave it as is. I don't know if I lowered it more, if it would come more into compliance, but it's about as close as I'm gonna get. I don't see it getting any better. Before I do this adjustment, I wanna torque these fasteners down since this is now in position. So I'm gonna lift it back up, torque these fasteners where they are, and then we'll set the side to side.
Sort of going off the instructions a little bit here, what they say is they want you to adjust the length and the height and then do the torquing. I'm doing the torquing first and then I'll adjust the length. Hopefully it won't be too mad at me. These go to 115 foot-pounds. And a part of me wonders how much that actually moved. And was it worth the effort? I'm not so sure. So that may be a controversial point in this video. It is what it is. The lower shock mounts get torqued down to 60 foot-pounds.
Okay, I just referenced our earlier measurement, which was, I believe, 1 7/8 from the tire to the fender, and right now it's like 2 1/8. So we need to lengthen the rod so that it pushes this back over this way. Might need to grab my wrench. So turning it this way makes it longer, which is what we're trying to do since this is the body mount and we're trying to force it over this way. I am gonna need that wrench though. This is 27 millimeter. It's a little easier to turn with a wrench. Let's check our measurement. It appears I went the wrong way because I'm just a shade over 2 1/4, so I gotta go the other way and actually draw it up a bit. Let's check it again. All right, looks like we're at 2 now, so we're going in the right direction. Oh, that nails it at 1 7/8. Check the other side.
All right, this side looks like it's about 1 3/4.
So initially our measurement was 1 5/8, and now we're at 1 3/4, yet the other side remains the same. I can't really give you an explanation for that other than maybe I was on a different part of the fender or went into one of the letters on the tires, something like that. I mean, we're close, but not dead on. And honestly, I'd prefer to measure it up against the body, and the instructions outline a procedure to do that. And I'm gonna check that now just to see where the tires are in relationship to the frame of the car. They did in the instructions outline a procedure to line the axle up with the body of the car. They used different measuring points. They used a point off of the bolt for the lower control arms that goes through the body. I'm not able to do that. I welded in torque boxes that make it so that any strings I hang out that bolt are gonna hang over the edge of that torque box. What I have found is on the frame back here, on both sides, there seems to be a hole in the same location. I'm gonna take my plumb bob and hang it from that hole, or put my thumb in it, and I'm gonna measure the distance from this line over to the tire. Now I've come up with, well, what I'm calling a clever method of holding the string up into the body there. And I'm gonna make sure I do it on both sides to where it's hanging over the same side. But so the plumb bob's hanging, I've got a straight edge going across the back of the tire. And I'll just take my measurement like this right here. And it looks like this side is about 2 1/4. Here's the hole on this side. In case you're wondering what I used, this is a rubber bleeder cover that seems to fit in the hole perfectly. And once again, I'm gonna hang it over the inside. It was 2 1/4 on that side. On this side, we are 2 7/8. That might be 2 3/4 with it settled out like that. So we got a good, almost half inch difference from one side to the other. So I'm gonna make the adjustment until I can get these even. So it seems we need to make the rod longer
because we've got less over on that side than we do on this side. So it's still close to 2 3/4. Well, maybe I'm going in the wrong direction. I did that before too. Definitely making progress. We're back to where we started at 2 3/4. Yeah, just under 2.5 still. A couple more turns and I'm gonna check the other side. Almost 3 inches over here. I need to go in the opposite direction for a few spins. And we got it down to 2 3/4. It's like 2 5/8. Okay, so the other side was 2 5/8, and this side is just over 2.5. So we're the closest we've been yet. So 2 5/8 over there, about 2.5 over here, we're wicked close, like within a 16th of an inch or so. So now I'm trying to figure out which way I need to turn this in order to decrease over there a little bit and add a bit over here. I think to add a little bit over here, I lengthen the rod. Okay, so that seems too much. Checking the other side, it's 2 3/4, or darn close to it, close enough to where it's not gonna affect much. Okay, so now it's even on both sides at 2 3/4 from our measuring point. Now it's time, I'm gonna raise it up to tighten the jam nuts. In there. Some of you might be curious, like me, now that we've got everything lined up the way it's supposed to be, according to the subframe. So what's the measurement between the fender and the tire now? Let's find out.
Looks like 1 3/4 on this side. And this side, also 1 3/4.
So at the beginning of the series, I did sort of a test where I rock the car back and forth side to side like this. And that's exactly the kind of thing the Panhard bar is there to control, to keep the rear end in place and oriented correctly with the body. So now I'm gonna do that same thing that I did initially and see what it does now. And we can compare them side by side. Seems a lot less than it was. And that noise you hear is just the axles because they're C-clips. So the axles do have some in and out movement. I think the only flex I'm seeing is in the tires. Before it was the control arms and the tires. Now I'm not sure how accurate this is, but I had a thought before we set everything up and got everything measured out according to the subframe. And I wondered if the shocks would be pointed straight up and down and if I could put an angle gauge on a shock to see if the differential was in there correctly, either as a quick check or to help me set it up. And come to find out that with everything set up correctly, the angle of the shock comes out at 90 degrees. Just saying, might be a quick way to set this up. Panhard bar installation. Now, you don't necessarily have to install this in concert with a torque arm like I did. You can install this if you just have a four-link suspension and you want to control the side-to-side movement. I'll put links in the description to tools, this kit, Maximum Motorsports, anything else that might pertain to this video that could be helpful to you. In addition, I'm gonna put a link in the description to EricTheCarGuy.com, which is where I ask you to go if you have automotive questions. If you wish to connect with me socially, it's Google+, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. I post repair videos on Fridays, so stop back and see me then. Be safe, have fun, stay dirty. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.